okay, that works. And Jim says to him, we don't want to be a city. We don't want to be a city. We don't want to have anything to do with legislatures or executives or judiciaries or police departments and fire departments and boards of education. No, no, we are a community and we will live under the rules of Howard County, whatever those rules may be. Okay, you know, what's the problem? I don't have to, I'm a Howard County, I have governance. We don't want any governance. Well, they're not all that short. The commissioners, they said, well, Jim, what do you want? What do you want? Well, there is something that we want. What we want is what we call new town zoning. Now, all the uses contained in new town zoning are the same uses contained in Howard County zoning classifications. Well, it's the same thing. And we're prepared to live by whatever those uses may or may not be, whatever the criteria may be that changes. But we want you all to agree and guarantee us that the ratios that we will apply on the 15,000 acres are etched in stone. What are you talking about? 10% open space, I'm making this point, I can't remember exactly because I am 84. 10% open space, 35-38% residential. We broke down the residentials into single family, attached, detached, multifamily, blah, 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 blah. And so much commercial, retail, R&D, go on, you go. And then of course a whole segment for public facilities, hospital, college, high school, middle school, elementary school, libraries, and all the rest of that kind of stuff. And we want you to guarantee us that we can have those ratios etched in stone. No problem. The second thing we want is we want fluidity. What are you talking about? Well, this is a comprehensive go we're going to do. So let's just take town center. We're going to be simultaneously doing the Exhibit Center Teachers Building, American City Building, doing the LPP for the sections. We're going to be doing all that before we improve it all the way up. The lake. We've got a lot going on simultaneously. And the bureaucracy of public hearings and all the rest of that kind of stuff is going to slow us down. And we are bipolar. What do you mean you're bipolar? Well, on the one hand, we're long-distance runners. Our project is 20, 25, 30 years to get to our objectives. But on the other hand, we're sprinters, 100-yard dash people. We want to get things done. We want to get things done now, blah, 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 and we want to do it in a multiple phasing kind of a way. So what we'd like you to do is kind of marry up with us in a de facto joint venture where your planners and subdivision people will work with our planners on a current basis, and by current, I'm talking about daily, weekly, whatever, as we move the process along, getting the approvals as we go down the road. Well, the planning people down in Howard County at that time, they thought they died and went to heaven. Because all of a sudden, here comes this exciting planning opportunity that they're going to be a part of compared to just doing plain old plain vanilla subdivisions and blah 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 and blah 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 and like that. And while I was there, it worked perfectly. I mean, as far as we were concerned, worked perfectly. So Howard County, through the county commissioners and whatnot, said, you got a deal. We're the governing group. You're a community of Columbia, you're not a city. We like what you're saying. You're going to live by our zoning classifications. You're going to live by our subdivision regulations, however they mutate, change, or whatever, over the next 20, 25 years. Sigh of relief. They leave. They go back. And then they go behind closed doors with their lawyers. And then we get to the point of how can we make sure that the political winds of the county and zoning, they don't change on us. And if they do change on us, we're really vulnerable. Because we got a 25-year project. And if they start changing our new town zoning, well, if we're 25% through the project, we got troubles in River City. And we can't let that happen. Now, how do we know that we're that vulnerable? And this will get to the second part of when we get into the development stage. But all zoning, as determined by the Supreme Court of the United States in the Euclid case going back to the 20s or whatever it was, all zoning is nothing but regulatory. That's all it is. And you don't have any vested rights in your zoning unless you actuate on it. So we got 15,000 acres. We've got 25 years we're going to be doing this. Yeah, we can start with, you know, Wild Lake and Tass Center. We can do all that kind of stuff. But we got all this other land floating around someplace. And we're vulnerable to the body politic, if you will, the political will, changing in terms of zoning. Well, how can we stop that? How can we prevent that from happening? Covenants. Well, when it came to the covenants, believe me, we're going to tell you, I'm pontificating now. No polemics. Since 1066 in Magna Carta, covenants have evolved all through common law. Maryland is a common law state. In fact, all the states in the United States are common law states other than Louisiana. That's a positive law state because it came from France. Go figure. So, common law state. And then we evolved Constitution of the United States, Constitution of the State of Maryland, blah, 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 court cases, rules, regulations, and as you go down the line. But forever and a day, covenants trump zoning. There's not a zoning law, a zoning anything that can terminate a covenant, can destroy a covenant, can change, modify a covenant. Can't do it. There's only two ways that you can get rid of a covenant, whatever that covenant may be. One is condemnation. And if a government authority condemns, then they got to compensate all the parties in interest to the covenant. And in the case of Columbia, where we got to the point we got, you can, you know, we have covenants all over. That's a lot of people. Or the parties in interest to the covenant, they, you'd have to have unanimity, unless the covenant says something otherwise, unanimity, all the parties to the covenant have to sign off on it, terminating it, modifying, adding to it, subtracting from it, whatever you want to do with it. It's a big deal. It's a big deal. Okay. Back then, there was a professorial genius in Maryland known as Russell Reno, taught real property law in Maryland. And everybody in the state of Maryland, judges, lawyers, whoever, if they had any confusion about anything that had to do with real property, you go to Professor Reno. And Professor Reno, talk about pontificating, I had him for three semesters, future interest, you know, statute, rule against perfect, on and on you go. When you went into his class, he did not use the Socratic method. He lectured, and he began, and he lectured on like a 50 caliber machine gun. And you got to be taking notes as fast as your little hands can be going down. And everything was a pearl. Everything was a pearl. And you better get it down, given the examinations. And you only got one examination at the end of the semester, pass, fail. Otherwise, you're in trouble in River City. And all the judges and lawyers, and seriously, if they had an ambiguity about what to do, they all, you know, went down to the law school and paid homage, and Professor Reno would solve their problems, whatever that might be. Okay. What Professor Reno did was cobble together existing property principles in relationship to covenants. And those real property principles have been around for years and years and years, but they never have been joined as a general proposition. And out of all that came the notion, the legal notion, of what we lawyers, real property guys, called a negative reciprocal servitude. That's a mouthful. And simply put, the examples would be all, if you own Black Acre, we lawyers talk Black Acre, White Acre, Green Acre. So if you own Black Acre, you own it in fee simple and you don't have any problems. So what's a servitude? So let's say I own Black Acre and I want to build a house on it. I can choose either by lighting the house at night with candles or calling BG&E on the phone saying I want some electricity. BG&E says, fine, I'll give you electricity, but I got to have an easement to come onto the property from the public road to your house in order to install all this stuff. That's a servitude. I grant the easement. That's a servitude. Well, my next door neighbor, Fred, Fred's a common name in my facility, Fred, he owns White Acre and we're contiguous and we get along and he wants to build a house. And so I say to Fred, hey, Fred, you know, instead of us each spending $5,000 for a driveway, why don't we get together and we'll have a joint driveway, half of it on your property, half of it on my property, and we'll share capital costs and maintenance fees and all the rest of it. Okay, that's a deal. That's a reciprocal servitude. Now we get to the real cutesy part, if you will. Negative. And the irony of a negative reciprocal servitude, everyone would think those are burdens, those are negatives on your piece of property, your kingdom, you know, your fiefdom, your Black Acre. But the irony is, economically, the more you do that kind of stuff, the more valuable your piece of property is because, you know, how much is a house with candlelight versus a house with electricity? With candlelight, it's worth $1. With electricity, it's worth $1.25. And on you go, and on you go, and on you go. Water, sewer, blah, 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 blah. The negative part of the negative reciprocal servitude was we're going to give rights to third parties who have no ownership interest in Black Acre or White Acre or anything else. Well, what are you talking about? Talking about the covenants. And those third party people that have these rights, they're going to tell you what you can do and you can't do with Black Acre. And they have the right to do that. Interesting. Lay people converted a negative reciprocal servitude, which is a mouthful, to what they affectionately call schema development. It's an integrity. It's a whole. Think Rembrandt. Think Van Gogh. Think what we were doing was we had a canvas, and we were going to paint on that canvas, and there was going to be all kinds of elements on that canvas, and it was going to be a comprehensive, integrated whole. And we were going to tie it all together and protect our new town zoning ratios. Ratios are the issue, not zoning classifications. The ratios were the issue. We're going to protect all that because we're going to lumber all 15,000 acres with negative reciprocal servitude covenants. And the day we closed on 15,000 acres, we immediately put on the CA lien. All 15,000 acres. And we follow that with an en blanc easement for the Baltimore Gas and Electric Company on all 15,000 acres. And then we came down layering covenants, village covenants, neighborhood covenants, townhouse covenants, condominium, call it whatever you want. We kept layering down these comprehensive covenants that applied to every inch of land in the 15,000 acres. We call those things horizontal covenants. So the lawyers thought, oh yeah, we did it. We know what we're doing. Well, the planners at HRD is a timeout. We're not finished here with these covenants. What's your problem? Well, the problem is, under the Howard County zoning classifications, most of those classifications had multiple uses you could do. So let's just stick with the commercial, and I'll use a building that I bought, a piece of dirt I bought in 1985. And the planner said, and this is critically important in terms of the integrity and the glue to what we were about. The planner said, we're going to have 100,000 people, give or take, 125. We're going to have so much retail, so much blah, 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 blah. I don't know where they got their algorithms. I don't even know if they called them algorithms back then. But we only want so many banks in Columbia. We only want so many gas stations in Columbia. We don't want to have any hardware stores in the village center. We don't want to have any liquor stores in the mall. And on it went and on it went to a finite detail of uses. So what we, the planners, are saying to the lawyers, we want you to make sure that on the land that we classify as commercial or retail or R&D or whatever it is, that you further prohibit a use. So when Dave Carney, pal of mine, high school, or law school, the whole thing, Dave Carney and I, when we bought a piece of dirt in 1985, I was glad to see that HRD was still doing it. When we negotiated a deal, all we wanted was office space. An office building. So HRD says, yeah, under your zoning classification in Howard County, you can do office, but you can also do these other uses. And we, HRD, Howard County's okay if you meet the criteria to put a bank in on your site, but we're not, because we don't want a bank there. We're going to put the bank someplace else. So the deed that we took had the general covenants, CA, village, town center, blah, 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 blah. But it also had a set of special covenants, we called them, which were attached as amendment, which said to little Johnny Healy, John, you can build your office building here, but you can't do anything else but. And you can't put a bank in here, and you can't do this, and whatever they were saying you could do under the class, can't do it. And those were the special. This is where we had vertical covenants that drilled down on the site itself and had nothing to do with anybody else in the village or in the town or whatever the case may be. And that fabric of new town zoning and covenants is what created the glue that pulled the 15,000 acres together. But what we must understand is that it wasn't a real estate project. Mr. Rouse was not building a real estate project. Mr. Rouse's dream had to do with the community of Columbia. And Mr. Rouse, his view of all of us in this room and everybody else universally was that we were all the same. We're all the same. We all have the same dreams. We all have the same aspirations. We all have grandpas and moms and dads and spouses and kids and grandkids and pals. We all want to achieve the hierarchy of virtue and whatnot, safety, peace, education, food, clothes. We're all the same. Now, we Army guys would like to say we're all the same on a hospital potty, every one of us. And we're all bleed red. And there's no difference among everybody in this room at that most fundamental, intrinsic, spiritual level. And that was his focus. Now, you have all kinds of communities. American Legion, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Rotary Clubs. They're all communities of one kind or another. Mr. Rouse just happened to think because he was in the real estate business, I'm going to do this community and I'm going to plop it down on a piece of dirt. But the focus was 100% community. The focus was never money. That's hard to believe. Most people don't believe it. You can say it and they say, oh, yeah. Oh, no. We were broke in 1972. We were insolvent in 1972. Now, in part, we were insolvent because Willard, Jim's brother or whatever, he died, and Willard was the break on Jim when it came to spending money. So that's how we got our headquarters building, Frank Gehry's building. That's how we got it. Back in those days, we had corporate overheads, and I was in the legal department, obviously, and our corporate overhead was $4.50 a square rent that had to get passed on to the other profit centers. After we built that building, our rent went to $26 a square. And we were insolvent. And that was resolved when whoever said something about Mr. Wild came down and said, Klaska comes out of the garage and up, we go back up to Hartford County, up to Hartford, Connecticut. Okay, what are we gonna do? Well, that's the point in time where Matt DeVito was elevated from general counsel to president of TRC, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And when Mr. Rouse went over to his foundation for the poor and all the rest of it, I can't even remember the name. Now, Matt, I know intimately. But for Matt DeVito, the Rouse Company and HRD would not have survived. That simple. But for Matt DeVito. Changed the culture. Became a real estate guy. Was a real estate guy. He was never committed to the culture of Columbia and the community of Columbia. That's the bad news. He always wanted to take the headquarters downtown Baltimore with the movers and the shakers at the Mercantile Club and all the rest of that kind of business. The board wouldn't let that happen. So here we are. And Matt takes the company going forward. I'm out of here. I'm not working for him anymore. But he takes the company and it survives. And then in part of the telling the story, it is Matt retires, Mike Spears made the head of city manager for Columbia. Mike Spears dies in an airplane accident up in Boston. Board calls Matt. I'm simplifying all this because there's obviously more to all these details. You can't do all this in an hour. But board calls Matt, Matt, would you come on back? Matt says, I'll come back, but I'm only doing it one time. You're not gonna keep calling me like I'm a yo-yo. And back in those days, the financing on the Rouse Company and HRD and what was all getting reset, and it would be reset for going through. So Matt says, "I'll come back on one condition: we sell TRC and we sell HRD." And the rest is history. And that's what happened. And here we are, and here we are, and here we are. So that's how that whole dynamic of the ratios and the fluidity and all the rest of it. But there is a first principle. The community of Columbia had one first principle. It was our spiritus animus, and I'm deadly serious by the use of these words. It was our raison d'etre. All issues were reconciled on this first principle. And the taproot of that first principle was manifested by the people tree. We were about people. We weren't about making dough. We were about people. And anyone who's been around as long as I have been, they will absolutely testify about what an electric period of time it was back in those days. It was spectacular. It was sparkling. It was energetic. It was Haight-Ashbury, Woodstock, Camelot from the Kent. It was all of that, and it all played in, and we were a part of that little boys' band. I mean, we were doing it on a piece of dirt. That was our gig, instead of being up, doing whatever. And his marching orders and all reconciliations of conflict was guided by the people tree. Now, what do I mean by that? HRD, we were a big outfit, a lot of people. And normally developers will hire, outsource their disciplines. So think about an orchestra. You got fiddle players, you got strings, you got, you know, horns, you got timpani, whatever you all got. You got all these different people playing this morning, but you need a conductor. And in internal to HRD, you had the bean counters. And I believe the bean counters, they needed therapy. Those poor guys, they had more spreadsheets you can shake a stick at. That whole wall would be lined up with spreadsheets. Mutations of every project, the public roads, whatever we were building and doing, and they would have to manipulate those numbers all the time as they got feedback from all the various sources internal. And Andrew's, And then we had engineers and construction people. And engineers, God bless them, as far as they were concerned, their idea of doing anything is paving. And you can take to the bank, those guys would fight with the planners and the architects inside HRD all the time. The planners wanted serpentine streets. The engineers wanted a cookie cutter. Bang, grid it. If you do it my way, it'll only cost you a dollar. If you do it Wanamaker's way of a serpentine street, it's going to cost you $2.25. Cost. So when I say money was not our issue. Then you had the peddlers, the guys that had to sell this stuff, had to sell it. Then you had the planners and the architects. They were writing on clean blackboards, whatever they wanted to do. And then you had us. And we were the guys that were always saying, no. What part of no do you not understand? You can't do what you want to do because there's a cemetery there. You can't put the Village Green in Wild Lake over that cemetery. It won't work. Oh. So there was always these conflicts. And if I had a penny for every time doors were slammed and files were thrown down on conference tables and people wouldn't talk to each other of their various different disciplines, I'd be a millionaire. But one thing I can tell you is for sure, all conflict was resolved by the people tree. At the end of the day, we'd put our baseball caps on and we would think people. And we would think, well, I want to be in the Village Green Strip Center. What do I want as a person? What is my expectation as a small businessman? What is my expectation as a homeowner in here or there or the next time? And on you go, and on you go. And whenever we started thinking like we were buying into Columbia, or we were going to own a residential house, or we were going to own an office building, our whole perspective would shift in terms of the resolution of whatever the immediate problem was on an operational basis that we were dealing with. So this taproot of the people tree, it's one of the reasons why we didn't have any churches. Typically, the size of us ought to have a Catholic church on one corner of an intersection, a Protestant church on the other one, a mosque or a synagogue on the other one. No. Mr. Roush, spiritual individual that he is, says, all these folks believe in God. Let them get together. We got the interface centers. Surprising how it seems to have worked out. At least it worked out when I was around here. You know, Fred talks to Bob talks to Sally talks, and they're on. Next thing you know, they got to work out their schedules. Next thing you know, well, do you have a hymnal? Yeah, I could take this one. What about that? No. Next thing you know, everyone's getting along, and they're all praying to God, their God, and, you know, whatever the case may be. Brilliant on Mr. Rouse's part, because he believed we were all the same, and he wanted to do everything he could to nurture that sameness, that spirituality in the human being, on the highest of levels in the hierarchy of virtues and values and all the rest of it. That people tree was everything for us. It was our North Star. It was the lighthouse if you're coming in from the North Atlantic. It drove everything and everybody in HRD. And my testimony would be all the people that were living in Columbia and working in Columbia, they followed the people tree. For those of you that weren't there when this was all going down, it was magical. And everyone bought into what the process was that we were doing. So at the end of the day, you know, we get into the developmental side, 65 to 75, give or take. And those are all the things that HRD did to make sure, and we were intolerant, totally intolerant. There was no wiggle room. We didn't compromise. You either took the covenants the way, we don't care whether you come in and build a house here. You don't understand. If you want to come here, you got to do it our way. You may think there's freedom, but we're as socialistic as you can get. And this is from a conservative. You're going to do it. If I had one conversation with lawyers on the other side who represented me, say, Counselor, I'm not going to insult you by saying you're misreading the covenants and the contract sale. I ain't going to tell you. You're reading it correctly. You need to tell your client that if he's coming to Columbia, he may think he owns that piece of dirt, but he doesn't own that piece of dirt. We're going to tell him what to do, when to do it. We're going to tell him whether he's going to have hawthorn trees or oak trees or tulip trees or where the bushes are going to be. And if you want to have a purple door, you're not going to get a purple door on your front door. And on it goes, and the siding and all, you know, and on you go. So when folks came into the exhibit center, everyday folks, residential folks come in, the people in the exhibit center say, here it is. Here's Columbia. And those that we guarantee you, we rep and warrant to you that 25 years from now, it's going to look like that. That's what you're getting. You're getting open space. You're getting a pathway system. You're getting all the rest of it. That's the way it's going to look. So when Gregory and Leanne came down to the exhibit center, let's say I'm making this part up, Gregory says, well, okay, we like what you're doing, but I want to live here, and my cousin, he's a builder, so he can build my house. No, sorry, Greg. If you want to be here, we got a model home park down here. We got a bunch of builders. You go on down there, and one of those guys, you pick out what you want. Well, okay, I pick out this house from Ryland, Columbia Builders, whoever, and I want to put it on that lot. You know, Ryland only owns these lots, and Columbia Builders owns these, and on you go, and on you go, and on you go. It was all designed painstakingly by the planners of HRD that it all would look the way it looked. And at the end of the 25 years, our ratios would all be in place, 10%, 35%, whatever the case may be. The demographics would probably be the same, 100 to 125,000. Densities would be the same. And that was our community. And that's what we were gunning for. And that's the whole time I was there. That's exactly what we ended up doing until I left. And then at least as far as the special covenants are concerned, when I bought a piece of dirt in 1985 to put up an office building, HRD was still attaching us. Special covenants besides CA and BG&E and town center covenants, and down you go, and down you go, and down you go. So it was a combination of the horizontal, the vertical, the integrity of the new town zone, and the legal operation and effect of the covenants, and think saran wrap. We wrapped a whole 15,000 acres with saran wrap, aka the covenants. And people, everybody in the city of Columbia has standing if they determine there's a breach in any covenant, in any village, any place. That's the negative part of negative reciprocal servitudes. And I'll take questions when I'm finished here, but wait a minute. Steady as she goes, impetuous, steady as she goes. And as I said, I'm not arguing with anybody. I know what I know. I know what I know to be foundational in real property law, foundational to the point where blocking and tackling is foundational in football, stops and start in hockey, catching and throwing in baseball, scales in music, and I could go on. It's foundational. It's 101. And one of the biggest problems I would ever have had over the years, when I got an attorney on the other side, and he doesn't understand that 1 + 1 = 2, and you got to start negotiating on that level, you want to say to the guy, son, you better get your money back from law school, or you better go back and do your homework, because I'm not going to waste my time about 1 + 1 = 2. And in my analogy, 1 + 1 = 2 is the legal operation effect of the negative reciprocal servitude covenants in, over the whole city of Columbia. So as the one of the most famous philosophers in America said, abba dabba dabba do. That's all, folks. Questions?
Bill, Bill, why don't you come over here and use this microphone and then hand it the microphone.
Got it. That makes sense. Thanks. I saw your hand up quite some time ago, ma'am. So
first, thank you for a wonderful talk, and I'm glad to see everyone here. Hello. If I could make my question one word, outparcels, but that has so much to it. When did it become clear that some farmers were not going to sell their land, and how did that work out?
Oh.
The decision how to work around them or with them or against them? Over to you.
I can give you an oblique. In the Army, we call it oblique. Civilians call it oblique. I can give you an oblique. Think of the invasion of Normandy. The folks down at Piper Marbury somehow pulled together guys like Jimmy Moxley, and it was a full court press. It was stealth. By stealth, they hit the county where the 15,000 acres that they had identified, I'm going to say simultaneously, because in real terms, time-wise, I think it was like a year and a half, and they all hit it at the same time and got all the commitments from the various different people, presumably not knowing what was afoot. I don't know. Jimmy's gone. You have to talk to his son who's down in security, and maybe he's got some back music. And that's the other thing. I'm not the only guy. I mean, all the lawyers are still alive that worked there other than Tom Garland. I mean, I know the planners that are alive. I know the peddlers that are still alive that are around. I know home builders that are still alive. If for some reason, in terms of the telling of the story, not the legal side, but I know you could interview all of them. And then if you could interview the Ruth Keatons of the world and the Maggie Browns of the world and on you go and on, all the folks that were community people and orchestra, I mean, they'll all tell you the same story. And what, their oral history may be a little bit differentiated than mine, but it's going to be the same thing. It was fabulous.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Would you mind standing up next to John so we're live streaming
sure.
This and it'll help with the movement of the camp? Can I get your hand? There you go.
Thank you.
I've understood, I think, most of the basic concepts. That you were talking about, but I didn't understand. If I live in Columbia, if I live in Wild Lake, I have the Wild Lake Covenants.
Correct.
Someone else lives in Hickory Ridge.
Correct.
Where we are now. And you're telling me that as a Wild Lake resident in Columbia, I have standing.
Correct.
In dealing with this parcel.
Correct.
Of property right here.
That's correct. Because why? Whatever you're talking about and you're referring, if what is being proposed is a breach of the ratios and the densities and all the things that were a part of Newtown zoning, then the legal operation and effect of the scheme of development and all the covenants is yes, you're absolutely right. If you're a resident of the Village of Wild Lake and somebody's doing something in Hickory Ridge or wherever the case may be, and you can prove evidentiary that it's in violation of Newtown zoning and the covenants, yeah, you got standing. But where the mistake has been made, so I've been told by Mr. What's your name again? The Roaches, you know, is what little I know, and I only know what I'm being told, and I don't believe anything I'm being told. And if I trust the source, then I'll trust the source, but I always verify. But what little I know is whatever's going on in Hickory Ridge or any place else around here, it's all in the context of the zoning sandbox.
Yes.
And that's masturbation. It's in the wrong place. It's an absolute wrong place, because the zoning dynamic cannot trump the covenants. If there's real bona fide issues that involve Newtown zoning and the covenants, the proper place to resolve that is in the Circuit Court of Howard County. And it's like going to moot court as lawyers, in moot court. The facts are obvious, so it's not a fact problem, it's a legal argument. What trumps what? Can a zoning classification change in Ken Howard County through its zoning county council or county zoning board? Can they interrupt, terminate, add or subtract zoning, in contrary to the Newtown zone? And I'm pontificating. I'm saying, no. Newtown zoning and the covenants, the saran wrap of the legal operation effect of all the covenants as layered, and so trumps any zoning initiative at all, period. Now, if that has happened since we left, went on about the way, in fairness to the people on the county council, the zoning board, CA, village boards, who's the Howard Hughes, everything, in fairness to them, everything inside me, and now I'm speculating, says they all got bad legal advice. If they got good legal advice and they ignored it, what I'm saying, shame on them. But they're not lawyers, and 90% of the lawyers don't even know what I'm talking about. And of the real property lawyers, I guarantee you 50% of the 10% don't know what I'm talking about. But the answer is that zoning can't do it, and it's a legal issue. It's not a zoning issue. It's a legal issue, and it belongs in the circuit court. Take it up to the Court of Appeals, and I put down $100,000 to the Court of Appeals. The highest court in the state of Maryland is going to say, covenants trump zoning. And you got to keep in mind, one of the reasons why that is so is we had a 25-year project, 30-year project, 100,000 people, 125,000 people. We had to make sure that we were not vulnerable to the body politic changing the zoning on us. And the only way we can make sure that happened was what we did.
Thank you. I have a question for you, John, if I may. Thank you so much. It was an amazing, I mean, I'm not just saying that, I loved it.
Before you say something, I was asked some time ago, do I have an agenda? Yeah, I got an agenda. My agenda is my passion and my love affair for Mr. Rouse. My passion and my love affair for all the people I worked with in HRD, advancing the people tree. Passion and a love affair of all the civilians that were a part of our community back then. It's a community. It's not a subdivision. It's a community. It's not anything other piece of dirt. No, it's a community. It's who we are in all of our universality. The same. That's it.
Well, could some of us...
Oh, please come on up. Please come on up here. Karen.
For some of us who moved here in August of 1967, that's what brought us. We felt the passion and moved from Towson and couldn't have been happier to be a part of this new town, this community, and it truly was a community.
Yeah. No.
Thank you so much for a wonderful talk.
It is a love affair.
Yeah.
And it's an exhilarating, it just wasn't a real estate deal based upon money.
So here's the question I have for you. The you mentioned the spirituality behind Jim Rousen over
yes.
and over again. I felt that the presence was in this room tonight, and I felt that that spirituality was what gave him the ability to convince Fred in that car.
Amen.
And, a lot of people will be cynical about the aspect of, oh, yeah, it's always about the money. And
yes.
cynical people are typically right. But when they're wrong, they miss out on the best part of life, don't
yeah.
they? And here's the question I have for you. We have people currently trying to change our community. You see, I believe the maximum zoning at the time, like you were saying, certain sections, there were classifications. And we're going to have residential, commercial zoning, residential, no more than 14 condos per acre, et cetera. There are people trying to crayon Donald Duck on the Mona Lisa and calling themselves the Da Vinci Project. And here's the question I have for you. How does that spirituality get affected when you see these wholesale changes happening that to what I thought was carved in stone covenants?
Well,
John, would you give the microphone?
Yeah. My response to that would be one person to another person. Our culture has so dramatically changed from, and I'll be simplifying it, God-fearing to secular. And once you move off of spirituality and the other, now see, my mom and dad drug me up about the other. My Jesuit education was about the other. If I had one Jesuit tell me, I'm not teaching you physics so that you can make them a lot of money. I'm teaching you physics so that you use it for the good of people, other people, that you advance that. I mean, that's the other. That's how we got drug up. I'm assuming Mr. Rouse, with his mom and dad, same thing. But when the sea change begins and you start walking away from that and you get into me, now, wow, in the moment, and you can't think out about, for want of a better word, common good and all the others, you start losing it. And then you start rationalizing it. And then you start justifying why you did what you do. And we're a mercantile society. I mean, we've gotten to a point, I think, that it's relativity, secularism, what all the buzzwords you want to eat. But I'm an old dog. I got raised differently. Yes, Mom. No, Mom. Yes, Mom.
Glad you're here, Jeremy.
Yeah, of course. Hey, John.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being here. I'm Jeremy Domeu. I sit with Bill on the Hickory Ridge Village Board. I write a blog basically documenting how Columbia is changing. My question for you is this. So I read a profile in, I think, Smithsonian Magazine about Jim Rouse, and the quote that stuck out to me in that article was he said something to the effect of, Columbia will never be finished, right? It will always be in a process of change, and he wants all the people who come to call Columbia home to be part of that change, right? And as
and the answer is no.
and as demographics change and as consumer preferences change, how do you think Rouse and how do you think you would invite that change in Columbia and in the way that
Woods, and I can tell you Mr. Rouse is been in his grave.
Mm-hmm.
Everything you're saying is true in terms of change,
yeah.
Cultural change, community change. That's all true. But insofar as 15,000 acres, densities, uses, etc., the open space dynamic goes to the culture and nurturing of mankind to have open space, to see the hawthorn trees and all the rest of it. He's spinning in his grave. Now, not while I'm thinking about it, and he said what he said. If, in fact, the new town ratios have been violated as we speak in 2022, and if, in fact, the covenants have been breached as we speak in 2022, and what has been done has been actualized, you can't undo it. You cannot undo it. That's basic fundamental law. If I did what I did, and I did it, under Howard County zoning or whatever the county council did or the zoning board did and all the rest of it, even though that was all wrong, I'm being simplified, doesn't matter. I got my building, I got it up, it's in violation of, doesn't matter, it's been built. You're never going to be able to get a court to say you can tear it down. But to the extent that if you did an audit of the ratios and the demographics, and you came to find out that in 22, the original dynamic of Newtown and the Covenants have been not only complied with, but overbuilt densities and all the rest of it, then legally you could prevent any future development of any of the open space lots or any of the rest of it. You could do that. But it's a legal issue. It's not a zoning issue. It's a legal issue. It's a legal issue. And if the Court of Appeals would come back and say, Healy, you're wrong. You're wrong. You got it wrong. Zoning trumps covenants. Well, then you know what the rules of the road are. But all this, why I call it masturbation, all this zoning, all this back and forth stuff, apparently it's been going on. It's a waste of time and energy, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you so much for that answer, and thank you for the question, Jeremy. Any other, Greg, you want to come on up?
Just an observation for you to comment on. If Mr. Rouse had in any way, manner, shape, or form anticipated changes to the physical character of Columbia as the burgeoning cities of Baltimore, Washington, you know, expanded outward, why would he and why would you all have gone to the extent and all the effort and work to embed the covenants with the land and have them run in perpetuity?
Well, I don't believe unless he was, you know, Alzheimer's, dementia, or whatever, he started, you know, taking dope or whatever. That man was as pure, from my experience and what I knew of him and knowing him and watching Mr. Rouse walk across the parking lot with his 500-year-old valise saying hi to everyone driving his six-cylinder or whatever Chevrolet, he was just a Joe, an everyday guy that was brilliant and creative and spiritual, but he was just a Joe. He talked to anybody. He was approachable. But it was about the people. It, like that lady said when she came in 1967, went to the exhibit center and whatever, fell in love with the concept. And we guaranteed her through our covenants, through our deeds, through everything else like that, that we told you that the hospital's going to be there, that hospital's going to be there. It ain't going to be someplace else. And the college, community college is going to be there. And the high schools and down, and the open space and Symphony Woods, it's going to be there. See, I can get kind of angry with all this. Well, I can get all, I'm passionate.
I'm loving life now. We're running a little bit late, though. I mean, should we probably take one more question, and then we're going to have to let everybody get on and vacate the center. This lady here has had her hand up for a while. Please.
I'm saying this or asking this as a covenant advisor for one of the villages.
Okay.
If, to use your example, the 15,000 acres is wrapped in saran wrap,
yep.
Why do the 10 villages have different rules and regulations? The covenants are not the same across the board.
They don't have to be in terms of each of the line items or anything else like that. What I'm talking about is the macro area of the developer, what scheme of development. What was the plan of the developer in doing what he did? It was to have a comprehensive saran wrap. The covenants on a village-by-village basis can change, can mutate. But one of the things, back to what I was talking about, you got to get everybody to sign off. In the early days when I was there, when we were going to put the Oakland Mills covenants on, there was a conflict, I can't remember what it was, in the proposed Oakland Mills to the Wild Lake. And what did we have to do? We had to go back to every owner of every piece of property in Wild Lake and their lenders. Why the lenders? Because we're a title state. We're not a lien state. We had to go back to every one of them and get their consent to the change. And we hired, I don't know, 100 people, and they all went out and knocked on doors, and we got it all. And it's all down in the land records of Howard County. But it doesn't have to be exactly the same in the minutia, per se. It's the what it all looks like in the whole nine yards.
That was fascinating. Let's have a big hand.
All right, guys.
And I'm sure, I know I could stay here much longer, but out of respect for your time and everybody else's, we'll need to vacate the center. We didn't charge an admission tonight, so we are collecting funds for a scholarship that Hickory Ridge is giving to worthy students in the area. So you can see the lady at the desk out the door if you care to make a donation. And that's right, in the back, if you want summaries of John, because he covered a lot of stuff in some dense material, if you would like summaries of that, we've made copies in the back for you. Thank you so much, everybody. Have a blessed night. Yes.